And welcome back to Coast Connections. There's a full-blown red alert crisis here on the west coast of Canada, Vancouver Island. Our southern resident orcas, those beautiful mammals, are actually starving to death here. And we're going to learn more about these beautiful creatures and what we can do to help them and what this crisis is all about. And to do us the favor of her scientific expertise, we have Rachael Merrett. Hi, Rachael.
Hi, nice
Rachael,
to see you.
Rachael, yeah, you're with the Georgia Strait Alliance.
Yes, correct.
And among other things, you are addressing the orca crisis that we have here in our waters.
Yes, absolutely.
Rachael, why are these mammals starving to death? What is it that they're eating and what is it that they can't find?
So the southern resident killer whales are a unique population of killer whales that feed up to 90% on Chinook salmon specifically. Mm-hmm. And we are well aware that our Chinook populations have been crashing for several years. Every year seems to be worse and worse. So the killer whales are essentially starving because they don't have enough food to eat.
Mm-hmm. And in the Fraser River, which is the 850-mile-long river, in North America, it has the biggest supply of salmon. The last count of Chinook, which you recorded through the
Albion test fishery.
Albion test fishery?
Yeah, it does the recordings to check how many salmon are coming up throughout the season. The last report I have from about a week ago is that they recorded a single Chinook this season so far.
One Chinook?
One. Yeah.
And if this is not a crisis, what is?
Exactly.
That's shocking. That's absolutely shocking. Now, if the orcas can't eat Chinook, would they be eating any of the other type of fish, or is that why they're starving? Is it this is very specific to their diet?
We know food preferences within killer whale populations are very specific.
Mm-hmm.
So southern residents eat a little bit of chum, maybe a little bit of coho, and even steelhead. But again, the majority of that diet is coming from Chinook, and so far we have not seen this population switch. It is a culturally ingrained habit for them to eat Chinook salmon.
Mm-hmm. So our numbers of orca sightings are down to what, Rachael, of the resident?
Normally we would see southern residents starting to come back into the Salish Sea in spring, especially in May. But so far there's just been a few sightings of J-pod in really early April. Mm-hmm. And since then we have not seen southern residents in our area.
That's shocking. And the Salish Sea encompasses Georgia Strait, Juan de Fuca Strait, and Puget
Harrow
Sound
Strait,
and Harrow Strait. So that's a
big area.
Big area.
Yeah, so exactly. We're not seeing them in any of those locations.
Mm-hmm. We're going to meet some of the orcas in a minute through some of your excellent photographs. But just remind us again, what is the difference between a resident orca and a transient orca? Because they are very distinct species.
For sure. Southern resident killer whales, even resident killer whales, primarily feed on Chinook salmon, but they are fish eaters. Whereas transient killer whales are mammal hunters. So neither population will switch to a different food source. They do have different dialects, so different languages. Mm. They have different cultures, different social structures, and will never interbreed with each other. So they are essentially almost different species from each other because they don't interbreed.
I think last time you were with us, you said it was 750,000 years.
Yes. Genetic segregation.
Since they last interbred.
So yeah, that's their most recent common ancestor.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So, Rachael, are the transient orcas also starving?
No, this is a great example of what happens when you have a depleted food source. Transient killer whales are listed as threatened, but they are steadily increasing because they have this abundant supply of harbor seals and porpoises and sea lions. Mm-hmm. Resident killer whales live in the same environment, yet they do not have an abundant supply of Chinook salmon. Therefore, their population is steadily decreasing.
Mm. Rachael, what are the threats to the Chinook salmon? Why are they not returning? Why do we not have them? What are the causes of this?
So the problem with Chinook salmon decreasing is not due to one specific item. Obviously, we have to look at our fisheries management because if we do not have enough fish returning to spawning grounds, our population is going to be depleted. But we also have to look at habitat destruction that we've had in our oceans and specifically on the rivers. So habitat restoration is a key part of it. We know that now there are diseases and parasites spread from Atlantic fish farms to wild Pacific salmon, and specifically seeing those diseases in Chinook salmon. So that's another piece of the puzzle. And finally, one that is not as easy to identify is climate change and how that's affecting the different species in the oceans.
Mm-hmm. And also with their echolocation, the way of communicating, the increased traffic in the Strait, in the Salish Sea,
is a
big concern. And how is that a concern for these orcas?
So when you look at killer whales who are using echolocation to find their food, one, if you have any type of vessel noise, that's going to impact their ability to basically detect their prey and then catch it. And so when we have something like the Kinder Morgan pipeline expansion with its associated tanker traffic proposed for our area, we're deeply concerned because those tankers pose threats to the whales not only through the noise volume, the potential for a vessel strike, but also the detrimental damage that an oil spill in their critical habitat would cause.
Rachael, you say we have 76 of these beautiful mammals left. So through some of your excellent photography, let's meet some of them now.
Okay.
And we're going to pop some of your photos up on the screen, and you're going to tell us a little bit about each of these groups and individuals, and a little bit about what the threats are and how their behavior is being altered due to some of the things that we're doing. Yeah.
Sure. So the first one you can see up on the screen is actually a picture taken of a super pod. And that's when we used to see all three pods come together, J, K, and L. And they would socialize, they hunt together, they're playing, they're interbreeding. But that is something we don't see anymore. Because of the depletion of their food source, the pods not only aren't coming together, we're seeing a fragmentation of the pods themselves. And in the photo that you can see, some of those whales actually aren't even with us anymore. And one is believed to have died from starvation, and the other one was struck by a vessel. So it's really sad to think that I don't have photos like this anymore in the last probably 3 years.
Wow. And the next photo that we have, Rachael? What's the average size of a pod?
It depends. L pod right now is our largest with 35. K pod has 18 and J pod has 23. Potentially what they could be, we don't really know because they're not at a healthy rate.
Right.
But I can see who you're seeing on the screen now. This is part of L pod. So the big male on the left is Cruiser. And Cruiser is very identifiable by that little bit of a wave he has in the top of his fin. He's the only male that we have that has that right now. And then he is with a younger L pod whale named Fluke. And Fluke is 14. And so we do tend to see these adolescent males when they're hitting puberty wanting to hang around with the older boys like Cruiser and get some kind of advice from them on how to navigate the world and maybe the ladies. But yes, it's just this mentorship we see with the older males.
And that's very important because they're very familial groups, aren't they?
Absolutely. And when we have fragmentations of the pods,
yes,
or we lose members, then we don't have that mentorship or that transfer of knowledge in some cases to younger generations, which is very worrying for the success of the population.
And our next photo that we have, Rachael, we're bringing it up any second here.
Oh, this is my favorite whale. It's K21 or Cappuccino. You can see he's got this big open saddle patch and a nick in the back of his fin. So he's really easy to identify. Cappuccino, though, is the only whale left in his family. He has no immediate family, no mother, grandmother, siblings. He was born in 1986, and so he's a mature male. He lost his sister Raggedy, or K40, in 2012. And when we have a lone male like this, he's not alone as in he's not of the pod, but when he's out of the periphery of the core pod. Our recent scientific research has shown that males who are on the periphery of social groups are the ones who are most at risk of starvation during times of low prey availability. So if we had abundant Chinook, we wouldn't be concerned about whales like Cappuccino. But because we have such a small food source for this population, we worry that Cappuccino could be on the outskirts. And that's all to do with food sharing. Females share 90% of everything they catch. So if he had more female family around him, they would be providing him with food as well.
Right. Wow. Cappuccino. Oh,
yeah.
Poor dude. Yeah. And what other family photo have we got here, Rachael? The next one that we're showing is...
This is actually another K-pod male named Lobo. He's K-26. Lobo is 25 years old this year, and that's significant because there's not a lot of scientific data showing that males under the age of 25 are siring offspring. So we're happy to see that he's got to that level, that he's 25, and hoping that his genetics are passed on soon. He's fairly good in consideration to Cappuccino, where his mom is still alive, and he has two younger siblings as well that he travels with. So, yeah.
Wow. And I think we have two more photos. Let's roll the next one here. There we go.
Oh. So this is just like a really great photo to see when the killer whales are side by side. And these two whales have a little bit tough names to pronounce. They were named by the Coast Samish First Nations. And so one is Haishaka, and the other one is Tilaminjis, which is her son. So it speaks to that these whales have a huge history on our coastline. They've been part of our First Nations, their culture, their language, their stories. Mm-hmm. And so it is important that we keep these whales around to maintain those cultural ties within our Indigenous communities.
Mm-hmm. Very good, yeah. Do you know what those names mean in English?
I forget right now what they mean. They do list
probably,
them,
yeah. Yeah. Probably something quite significant.
I believe one of them is blessing.
Oh, yeah. Well.
And they are.
Yeah, yeah, they are. Certainly when you go whale watching and you see a whale, that truly is a blessing.
It's a transforming moment.
It is, isn't sure. it? And yeah, we all lose if we lose these beautiful, beautiful animals.
We do.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not just the whales. It's yeah, our entire it's community.
Yeah, and the planet. And one more picture, I believe, we're going to roll. Two more.
So I actually included this photo because this is a transient killer whale named T11. Mm-hmm. She's a female. She's been around since 1963.
And, wow.
Yeah, she's an old lady now.
Yeah.
She has one son, and we call him T11A. They don't have the fancy names all the time, the transients. So they are the mammal hunters. And last summer, this female and her son were seen throughout the entire summer in the Salish Sea. They're very, very popular. They're very successful at hunting seals. Mm-hmm. And again, just speaks to this problem that residents don't have food, transients have food. One's doing good, one is not.
Mm-hmm. Wow, what a difference. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And our final photo, Rachael, from your lovely collection.
So this is J34, which is double stuff. Double stuff was actually killed by a vessel strike, and they found his body floating near the Sunshine Coast. Mm. And his injuries were consistent with blunt force trauma, and they do not believe he actually died right away, so he did suffer. Mm. Again, speaking to the risk of increased vessel traffic in our area, double stuff was only 18 years old, so likely didn't pass on genetics in the population. And now his mother and his younger brother are the only ones left in their family. So again, just speaks to the loss that this population has experienced mm-hmm. in the last couple of years.
Mm-hmm. And it speaks to the urgency of the problem here. And I know the Georgia Strait Alliance has recently petitioned Minister LeBlanc, mm-hmm. Fisheries and Oceans, Minister McKenna of Parks Canada, that something has to be done immediately about the Southern Resident crisis here. Tell us a little bit about the petition that you sent and what the response has been so far.
Sure, so we're the coalition of our allies that put out this petition at the end of January. Mm-hmm. And basically what we're asking is that the ministers recommend an emergency order to protect Southern Resident killer whales. Emergency order is found in Section 80 of the Species at Risk Act, mm-hmm. and it does give the government the tools to implement regulations immediately so that they don't have to go through the red tape of doing that through legislation and acts. Mm-hmm. So some of the things we wanted to see from the emergency order would be increasing the designated and protected critical habitat within the Salish Sea. There's a couple zones we have. We want to see feeding refuges along the Strait of Juan de Fuca and in Harrow Strait, where there would be no fishing in those areas. And that would give the whales less competition for food. And those areas were based on where we see high foraging levels in the killer whales. Mm-hmm. We'd also like to recommend that other boats that are whale watching, whether that's commercial or a private vessel, also not be allowed to watch Southern Resident killer whales in those areas. other whales would be fine, transients or humpbacks or gray whales, but just to give southern residents that space and that opportunity to get to their food source. Mm-hmm. We'd also like to see the 200 meter viewing distance regulated and forced on the water, as well as vessel slowdowns around the whales so that they, again, have less disturbance from vessels. And then looking at the shipping industry and how that impacts the whales. So having a slowdown zone, as well as a lateral displacement of the ships so that they move away from those foraging areas when we have killer whales in the area. Mm-hmm. So far, we have not had a response. We haven't seen any actions implemented yet.
And that was sent in January of this year, January 20th?
Yeah, January 30th is when we sent it, and we asked for a response by March 1st. But we have not seen any actions implemented to this point. So we continue to push for those and, and ask members of the public to sign that petition. You still can on any of our websites, including Georgia Strait Alliance's. And to contact your MPs and tell them that this is an issue that you care about and you want this population protected.
Rachael, it sounds really shocking to me that, I mean, we're talking about down to one Chinook salmon. I mean, this is like the same crisis that the East Coast cod fishery faced, and how horribly desperate that whole situation was on not only the marine life, but the communities, the cities, the towns, the villages of Eastern Canada. No cod, now we're faced with no Chinook. Like, I mean, this is a full-blown crisis that really needs to be looked at.
And, it's not just Chinook. A lot of the populations of Pacific salmon and steelhead have gone down. So it's concerning on a complete coastal level with all of our salmon.
So let's talk about some of the good news, and thank you for what you're doing trying to push through that petition, the emergency order.
Because
I know other steps have been taken. There's been a lot of plans, a lot of action steps, but not a lot of action behind the proposals.
Suggestions. And good intentions, but so far, no action.
So thank you for what you're doing and helping the public to do to get involved in getting some action behind this to help these amazing animals. So, Georgia Strait Alliance, June is Orca Month coming up. You've got some really good activities. Tell me a little bit about the film that you have coming out.
Oh, so Georgia Strait Alliance will be hosting the 9th annual Festival of Ocean Films. And we're doing On the Road this year. Typically it's been in Vancouver, but this year on May 30th, it'll be in Victoria. And then on May 9th, we'll be on Pender Island. And our feature film is called Sea of Life. And it's a great documentary about all the different threats that are facing the ocean. And our filmmaker will actually be joining us after the video and answering questions on Skype. And then near and dear to my heart, my favorite coming up in the videos is a short documentary called The 100-Year-Old Whale by Mark Lear and Young. He's also an author that wrote The Killer Whale Who Changed the World. And the documentary features Granny, which we're all very familiar with, Granny J2. She was 105 when she passed away in October of 2016. So it's a really beautiful tribute to her life and the impact that she had on this entire population for over a century.
And Rachael, how did Granny pass?
We don't know, like, officially to be able to confirm, because her body did not wash up. But I have talked to some researchers in the field, and they believe her granddaughter, which was J14, passed away before her a few months. And apparently Granny's body condition was not great. She was looking thin. And with her granddaughter passing away, potentially Granny was trying even harder to share her food with the rest of this Maitre line, which spanned five generations. So we don't know for sure if starvation was the cause, but it's definitely thought that it might have been a factor and not age.
Now at 105, how does that rate on the orca life scale? Have there been orcas that have been older than Granny?
She's the oldest known killer whale in the world, or was. And the next oldest one that we know of is in El Pod, and her name is Ocean Sun. She's L25. And we believe she was born in 1928. So she's 90 this year. Mm-hmm. But typically a lifespan for a female killer whale tends to be the 60 to 80 year range, mm-hmm. If everything goes well and we don't have periods of low food abundance, really. Mm-hmm.
Right. And if all goes well, do transients live longer than residents, or is their lifespan sort of generally the same?
Generally the same. We do have not as much detailed data on some of the transient killer whales just because they're a little bit harder to study. Mm-hmm. They never used to be in shore as much as we see them now. But yes, they're very similar in lifespans.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Good. And you're also... there's a very interesting swimming event taking place around Salt Spring Island. Tell us about this.
There's a lovely lady named Rama De La Rosa, and she is going to swim around Salt Spring Island this summer, which to note is 100 kilometers. And she wants to raise money for Georgia Strait Alliance and our work to protect southern resident killer whales. Rama actually did this swim last year to raise funds for Pull Together, which supported the lawsuits basically that the First Nations had with the Kinder Morgan pipeline. And when she was on her swim last year, she actually had a killer whale come right up to her and pass underneath her, beside her, four times. I've talked to her, she said she wasn't scared, she's just soaking up the moment, but that inspired her to basically want to do something for our coastal whales. Mm-hmm. And so she learned about southern resident killer whales and their plight. And so now she wants to do this swim and raise money for the southern residents.
That is fantastic.
Yeah, I think it's great to note with Rava, she does this without a wetsuit, without a dry suit, just in her regular swimsuit. And she spends 6 to 8 hours in our waters, which are 10 to 12 degrees Celsius. So it's a pretty amazing feat. We really appreciate having her.
That's incredible. And is she doing the 6 to 8 hours? 6 to 8 hours is what it takes to get around Salt Spring?
And over several days.
Okay,
so she'll
yeah.
do about 13 to 17 kilometers a day.
Yeah, I was going to say 6 to 8 hours, she'd be a really fast swimmer.
She'd be a porpoise.
She'd be a porpoise, yeah.
Yeah, so it'll take her 4 to 5 days is what she thinks. But
very good. Wow,
yeah.
Good for her.
Yeah, so we'll have more details about the swim and any upcoming promotional events on the website and our Facebook, so you can kind of keep up to date on where that's at.
Are you going to attach a camera to her this time in case?
She has a support boat, and so they'll be filming from the boat. And I believe she'll bring a GoPro sometimes to have underwater footage.
Yeah.
And then we'll be doing some videos with her.
Fantastic. Yeah. And there's a photo contest also as part of Orca Month?
Yes, we want to start running our photo contest at the beginning of Orca Month, but we're actually going to continue it through summer just to give everyone lots of opportunity to submit photos. And being that we are trying to save the southern resident killer whales, the theme is to send in your favorite picture of the southern residents or a southern resident.
Yeah.
And then towards the end of August, we'll have some winners. So we'll, have all the details again on our Facebook and website.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you're going to be at some of the local events and festivals and things this summer as well. I think Pender Island's one of your locations.
The video, the VFOF. But for World Oceans Day, we'll be in Vancouver on the Saturday,
so it's
the 9th, where we'll be having an education table set up, and then there'll be a beach cleanup as well. And that's at a meeting at the Plaza of Nations at 12:30 for the beach cleanup, but the tables are set up around 10. And then we'll be in Victoria at Fisherman's Wharf, which is a fantastic place to hang out.
Yes.
Where we're going to have some of the students join us from our school program that we launched this winter. It's called the Youth Video Challenge to Promote Healthy Marine Environments. Mm. So we have kids from grade 4 to grade 8 who did these videos, and they're going to come down and talk to people about their project, which is focused on ocean threats and how to mitigate our impact.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
On these ocean cleanups, what's one of the most unusual things that you found? Besides cigarette butts.
Very common. We've had some nasty things. We found some needles. I found a lot of fishing gear, actually, on one that we did in Esquimalt Harbor in Victoria, which is kind of an odd spot for big fishing buoys to be found.
Totally. And speaking of fishing gear, we have a little bit of time left, the Ghost Gear Initiative that the Georgia Straits Alliance is involved in. Tell us a bit about that.
So the Global Ghost Gear Initiative is a cross-sectoral alliance of stakeholders all around the world that could be fishermen, scientists, recycling NGOs, artists, you kind of name it. And we're all collectively working together to reduce the amount of fishing gear that's lost in our oceans, mm-hmm. which right now is estimated at 800,000 tons a year. And so we want to work on preventing the gear from getting in the water in the first place,
yes.
removing gear that's already in the water, and then being able to find recycling solutions once the gear is removed or at the end of life so that it doesn't go in the oceans.
Mm-hmm. When you think about it, you know, the oceans that Granny swam in back in the 1920s are totally different oceans than what we're dealing with today. And
Absolutely.
Case in point is that volume of fishing gear.
Yes.
Yeah.
Soon we will have more plastic in the ocean than by weight than fish. And that's a really scary statistic. Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a whole nother show. We'll have you back for that.
Yeah.
So thank you for everything that you're doing there with the Georgia Strait Alliance. Good luck with Orca Month.
Thank you. Hope everyone gets to join.
Yeah. And there's some really good information on your website, how people can get mm-hmm. involved with the ocean cleanups, the petition, all those types of things, Rachael.
Absolutely.
So thank you for your endeavors, and let's hear it for the orcas. Hopefully we can help them to come back. And
yes, we appreciate it. We all need to be in this together.
We are.
We're going to lose them. So it's now or never.
Yes. Thanks, Rachael.
All right.
And
thanks.
Hopefully you'll get involved in as well to help the orcas. Check out the Georgia Strait website. And let's keep connected. Let's keep the orcas connected here on the coast as well. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.